Morning, everyone. Today's topic is bronchoscopy in COVID in the era of COVID pandemic. So I'll be talking about these readings, like what is the role of bronchoscopy in diagnosis of COVID-19, the risk of transmission of infection during bronchoscopy, what are the indications of routine bronchoscopy, is there any need for revision of indications in the COVID era, the need of testing for COVID-19 before routine bronchoscopy, how to safely perform bronchoscopy. Coming to the role of bronchoscopy in the diagnosis of COVID, it has a limited diagnostic role due to the substantial risk of transmission, as it is a high aerosol generating procedure. The collection of upper respiratory samples via nasopharyngeal and oropharyngeal swabs are non-invasive and less contaminating option. Coming to the diagnostic sensitivity of the upper and lower respiratory specimen collecting techniques, the research is scanty. The lower respiratory specimen collection techniques, which are less invasive than bronchoscopy, are blinded bronchial sampling, blinded production brush, and non-bronchoscopic mini ball. So the role of bronchoscopy and ball in COVID-19 patients, there is a role in patients with severe or progressive disease requiring intubation. If additional specimen is needed to establish a diagnosis of COVID-19, the all previous smears has come negative and a need is there to establish a diagnosis, or to establish an alternative diagnosis which will change the clinical management. This is an article which compared the diagnostic accuracy of upper and lower respiratory samples and compared the viral distribution and shedding between the mild and severe cases. It included 213 patients who are already diagnosed case of COVID-19. Majority of them were mild. 37 of them were severe. So a total of 866 samples were taken, 205 throat swabs, 419 nasal swabs, 142 sputum, and 229 ball samples, which was predominantly done in patients with severe disease. So they categorized these sampling taken at different time period, from 0 to 7 days from the onset of symptoms, 8 to 14 days, and more than 15 days. So in the initial 1 week, the sputum had the highest yield, which was followed by a nasal swab. So in second week, the ball had a ball which was done in 12 patients with severe disease had a good yield. However, it was done only in limited number of patients with mild disease. Also, the sputum followed by nasal swab had a good diagnostic yield. So you can see in only mild cases, only 53, the yield of nasal swab was still low. So in the next 15 days, still ball had a higher yield, mainly in the severe subset. We don't know the mild subset, it was not done. And followed by the sputum and nasal swab. So this study has certain limitations, like all the patients were all previously diagnosed and not all the samples were taken in all the patients. So especially ball was taken only in patients with a severe subset. So we cannot equate the same to patients with a milder disease. And moreover, it's peer reviewed and the data is still unpublished. Coming to the risk of transmission of infection during bronchoscopy, it's one of the high aerosol generating procedure. So which poses significant risk to healthcare providers. The specific data on the risk of infection with COVID-19 during bronchoscopy is not available. However, there was a systemic review in patients with SARS infection. The risk of transmission to healthcare workers they reported an odds ratio of 1.9 for bronchoscopy. Less than intubation and tracheostomy. So, is there a need for revision in the indications for bronchoscopy in a routine practice? So, the recent chest guidelines have given the emergency indications and non-urgent indications. The emergency indications will be severe or moderate. Symptomatic tracheal or bronchial stenosis, symptomatic central airway obstruction, massive hemoptysis, and migrated stent. So the urgent indications are lung mass suspicious of cancer, mediastinal hyaluronopathy suspicious of cancer, whole lung lavage, foreign body aspiration, mild to moderate hemoptysis, and suspected pulmonary infection, patients who are immunocompromised. So now other indications like mild tracheal stenosis for clearing of mucus, suspicion of sarcoidosis, ILD, chronic infections, bronchial thermoplasty or vapor therapy in COPD, chronic cough and other evaluation are coming into the non-urgent bronchoscopy. So what about patients in lung cancer? So the lung cancer in the area where the community transmission is present, it has to be done in a timely and safe manner. So considering the risk of progression of the disease when we delay the bronchoscopy, and this is a grade 2C evidence. The therapeutic indications in patient on confirmed patients who are intubated for airway clearing airway secretions, and in case of lobar prolapse due to pooling of secretions are mucus plug. So is routine testing needed before routine bronchoscopy? So in the CHEST guidelines say patients who are suspicious of COVID-19, they have to be tested before performing bronchoscopy. In asymptomatic patients, in area where there's a community transmission, testing is indicated. When the test is positive, we have to postpone all the non-emergent bronchoscopies. Also, you have to aware about the false negativity rate in patients with asymptomatic individuals. So the testing is basically reduces the risk and does not eliminate it completely. So suppose in a positive patient, how long to wait? So in confirmed COVID infection, you have to wait for at least 30 days from the resolution of symptoms with negative testing for at least negative testing of two swab collected more than 24 hours apart. So at least a 30 days window is required in patients who are confirmed before doing a bronchoscopy. This depends on the indications. So I'll be discussing the further slides based on these two guidelines rather than expert panel report. One is from CHEST and American Association of Bronchology and Interventional Pulmonology, and this is the second article, the practice statement from expert panel. So what are the various infection control measures? The reduction, first is the reduction of staff to a cold cream. The bronchoscopist, the assistant, and if anesthetist team is involved, restrict to them. The patient should wear a surgical mask in the pre-procedure area, bronchoscopy suit, and recovery area. So use of complete PPE, disposable gowns, disposable gloves, cap, either N95 or FFP3 mask, and safety glasses or face shields. For flexible bronchoscopy, transnasal access is preferred with additional use of slotted mouth and nasal protector for the patients. And the use N95 masks should be discarded at the end of the procedure. So even in patients who are asymptomatic or even after negative COVID testing, it's better to wear PPE because of the testing is not 100% sensitive. Also in asymptomatic patients, they're found to have carriers, even if we don't test them. So intubation using fiber optic bronchoscopy should be avoided. If bronchoscopy is performed, we have to limit ourselves to tracheobronchial lavage or bronchial valve lavage, and should not go with transbronchial lung biopsy or needle aspiration in the same procedure. So avoid rigid bronchoscopy and jet ventilation if possible. So in the CHEST guidelines, there have been emphasis on this powered air purifying respirator. So commonly we use N95 in bronchoscopy. So there are no studies to compare both. However, this PAPR has a higher assigned protection factor, which ranges from 25 to 1000. The higher the number, the better the protection. Whereas N95 has a factor of 10. It is easy and comfortable to breathe. They're reusable. It has an additional face shield, so no need for a separate face shield. So breathing is easy and wearing is comfortable. Our N95 needs a tight seal around the procedure. It can become uncomfortable or prolonged use. Our PAPR, it's costly. The availability issue is there, and the maintenance is also high because it's battery powered and it can have some issues. Regarding the reuse or prolonged use of N95, the CDC recommends extended use. That is, the same N95 mask can be used for consecutive patients, and reuse, it can be donned or doffed multiple times for 8 hours, either continuous or intermittent, may be acceptable provided it is not damaged and it is not hard to breathe through or contaminated. And we have to follow appropriate hand hygiene measures. So these are the summary from various international guidelines, the CHEST guidelines, the Spanish guidelines, the German and the Chinese guidelines regarding bronchoscopy. It's divided into patients who are non-COVID and patients who are COVID positive. So non-COVID positive, always try to postpone elective procedures, screening and testing before the procedure. Ideal setting will be a negative pressure room with limited personnel. The patient has to be provided a slotted mask if transnasal or transoral approach without advanced airway. The mask can be used as N95 FFP3 mask. Other complete PPE, and in case of anesthesia, avoid atomized or nebulized lignocaine. Sedation to minimize the cough. And the consensus is to avoid rigid bronchoscopy. And regarding the use of reusable bronchoscope, disposable bronchoscope, there is no consensus in non-COVID patients. Closed circuit ventilation if advanced airway is used. Avoid jet ventilation. In case of COVID patients, the same thing, like elective procedures has to be postponed till 30 days. And ideal setting will be a negative pressure room with a limited personnel. Use of a PAPR offers a superior protection than an NT mask in confirmed patients. And regarding the equipment, disposable bronchoscopes if available. So these are the single-use bronchoscopes, and they have a number of advantages. There is no need to prepare or clean the scope before the procedure. So they have a small portable screen which can be reused since there is no risk of cross contamination. However, the cost and other issues we don't know. It's not available in India as far as I searched. So two companies are providing it, one is Broncoflux and the Ambu. It's been available abroad for use. So regarding certain modifications, like this intubation boxes used by anesthetists, a pulmonologist in Nagpur has devised a box for bronchoscopy. So these procedures can be used in future approach to prevent aerosolization. So to conclude, bronchoscopy patients with COVID-19 is a high-risk procedure. It should not be used as a routine means for the diagnosis of COVID-19. The indications for other diseases should be carefully considered in the COVID era. Testing for COVID is necessary before bronchoscopy. It's a consensus statement. And use of PPE and strict adherence to infection control measures may limit the risk of transmission. Thank you.